MPs are back in Ottawa tomorrow after a two-week break, and you can expect the Prime Minister will be facing opposition questions about how his government has responded to foreign interference allegations in the last two federal elections. Opposition leader Pierre Poilievre says Justin Trudeau should call a public inquiry.
We can't simply bury it behind closed doors and have it in secret while Canadians are left in the dark, potentially with another election interfered in before the results of the commission come out. The results of the commission and the regular testimony must be public.
Justin Trudeau has resisted calls for an inquiry, saying his government is taking the issue seriously.
We have the process that we put in place that is professional, independent people working with the public service to make sure thresholds are met.
To talk about all of this, I'm joined by our Inside Politics panel. Bob Fife is the Ottawa Bureau Chief with the Globe and Mail, and Stephanie Levitz is with the Toronto Star. A big week on the foreign interference in China file. Steph, how do you think the Liberals have handled this?
You know, Justin Trudeau has ducked more questions than there have been spy balloons shot down by NORAD over this one, really.
And that's saying something.
And that is saying something, because he's been asked numerous times over numerous days to explain himself, to talk about how much information he had, to defend specific MPs that have been accused of being directly influenced by name by the Chinese state. And he ducks it every time, which leads us to wonder, why can't Canadians have more information from the Prime Minister? And I know that it's interesting because he doesn't even trot out the national security line, like, I can't comment because it's a matter of national security. He just ducks and weaves and bobs around it. And that is adding increasing fuel, I think, to the political fire around this, because perhaps with some measure of additional transparency, we could get some answers and that could see some of the pressure fall off.
Bob, why do you think they won't provide these basic answers? I mean, we've asked multiple times about what he knew about allegations against a Liberal MP. That Liberal MP denies those allegations, but the Prime Minister won't confirm or deny whether or not he knew about those allegations. And if he didn't, you know, it would be beneficial for him maybe to say he didn't, but maybe that throws staff under the bus. I mean, what's the calculation?
He's been all over
here?
The map. When these stories started to come out, based on CSIS documents, by the way, he said his first thing was, CSIS, hunt down these people. We should really be concerned about it. Hunt down these people who are leaking this sort of stuff. And then he said, well, there's nothing to see here because we've always mentioned before that there has been interference in election campaigns. And then he said, oh, the political parties are being partisan and they're undermining democracy. And then when Global did the story about Liberal MP Han Dong, he resorted to racism, that this is racism by doing this. And now he's saying that there's absolutely no, he's resisting efforts for a national public inquiry, which there should be, because if you have a judge who holds public inquiry, he can see the secret documents behind closed doors. He can have subpoena powers to call CSIS officers or any national security person or the cabinet ministers. And the best part about it, I mean, some of it will be in public, some of it won't be. Best part about it is we'll get recommendations to make sure this doesn't happen before the next election campaign, because it is a very serious issue.
Stephanie, do you think they're going to bow to the pressure for a public inquiry on this?
It depends on how much pressure the opposition is willing to place, really. I mean, this is a minority parliament. The opposition, yes, they moved a motion and voted a motion at committee that there ought to be a public inquiry. That is not a binding motion on the government. Fair enough. However, they are the opposition parliament. If they would like, I mean, the opposition, you know, parties, if they would like to hijack the government's agenda, if they would like to hold the government's feet to the fire, I don't know, refuse to vote on things, filibuster a committee, they've got lots of little tools at their disposal that they could needle away at the Prime Minister on this one until he bows and does something about it. And I think that there probably are signs within, you know, the PMO and elsewhere that are starting to emerge that they are sensitive to the notion that the trust in government, which was already fragile to begin with, let us not forget, right, is being undermined by this. Not necessarily, there is the issue, of course, of foreign states undermining confidence, but there is the public trust in government. And the public trust in government is sacrosanct here. This is about elections. This is about democracy. And if Trudeau is serious in saying all the things that he said, they have to be thinking a little bit about, is there some other layer they can put on here that restores public trust to have people believe in what they're saying, which is that, don't worry, we're on top of it, we know this is happening, and we're working on it.
Bob, where do you see it going?
Well, look, right now, they put the wagons around the Prime Minister. They don't really know how to respond to this, but There is some simple things that they can do. One, hold a public inquiry, get a respected judge, somebody that all the opposition parties will agree to, bring in a foreign agent registry, which is the Australians and the United States have, which means that lobbyists and former politicians and lawyers who, or people who work in the media who may be being paid by the Chinese state or Chinese state enterprises, you will know who they are. Then you have to change the CSIS Act so that CSIS can be far more outgoing about warning the public about issues like foreign interference. And thirdly, change the criminal code to make foreign interference a criminal violation. Those are solutions that lots of people who are security experts, as you know, have advocated for this, and they do not want to do it. And the opposition keeps saying, you know why they don't want to do it? Because those documents show that China favored a liberal minority government and they wanted to defeat conservative MPs.
Well, Steph, one of the things that I keep hearing is, and we know from Bob's reporting about the allegations that the Chinese diplomat was bragging about trying to influence so there would be a liberal minority government. I've heard from some conservatives as well that they're getting pressure to stop talking about China. They were late to the public inquiry call. It was the NDP who put it out there first. And what some of these political insiders say is, look, there is foreign interference from more than just China. There's from other countries as well. And so there's resistance from the two main political parties to make changes because right now they're basically run as private clubs. And I don't mean that as an insult. They're literally run as private clubs. And the nomination process and a lot of the stuff that goes on where you can get involved and manipulate behind the scenes, they don't want anybody looking at it. Do you think there's political will to create not just transparency from the intelligence agencies, which we absolutely seem to need more of, but also accountability for the parties in this?
No. I mean, I think political parties, like you say, they're a closed shop. I mean, just think about on the surface of it, they're not subject to access to information regulation. They hold a bunch of data about people, and they don't have to tell anybody what it is. Their financials, you know, are transparent to a point, but generally pretty opaque. I mean, I think with the conservatives, what they're sensitive to, and this dates back some years now, is that the stance that they've taken on China has alienated voters. And they know it, they've heard it, they've been told it. It's beyond sort of the second, you know, the piece of Chinese interference perhaps costing them votes. They themselves are costing themselves votes, and they don't know how to square that circle. How do they adopt a foreign policy line that might be in line with conservative ideology as it relates to China, but not alienating voters in the process? And that's the thing they're struggling with. But the interesting thing about nomination contests, you know, I think we all know, right? These are really hard fought often, right? This is where the grassroots, the grind of politics really happens. And you would think to some degree that folks would be really on guard there for interference. And so it's an interesting question about how political parties internally might choose to beef up their own. Because that's a missing bit in all this. Mm-hmm. You hear some of the questions coming out, right, where I'm waiting for the political parties to say, okay, well, here are the things we've been doing as political parties to change our process, to make things easier, to make it more transparent. They're not doing it. They don't seem to outwardly be taking this seriously themselves, even as they stand in the House of Commons and yell and scream about a public inquiry. I mean, you know, reports recently, some of the political parties even turned down security briefings during the election. So either they're taking it seriously as a matter of national security, or they're just using it to be a political football, and I don't think that's the right approach either.
Bob, given what Stephanie just said, the Prime Minister suggests that this should go before parliamentary committees. A lot of folks would say that's the right place for it.
That's not, why not the right place? First of all, because we've seen the committee. It gets into partisanship, ridiculous questions, the Liberals trying to not provide answers, filibustering, the Conservatives interested in scoring partisan points, not trying to get at the truth. And when the CSIS provides documents to committee that they've requested, they're all blank. They don't talk about what we know are in those documents, which is social disinformation campaigns that say false things about candidates, cash transfers to candidates, hiring of students studying here, international students studying here to help preferred candidates, tax people contributing money to parties and then they get repaid back minus the tax receipt that they get from the government. Those are really, really serious issues. You're not going to get that in a parliamentary inquiry. You will get it in a public inquiry.
Really serious issues, and we'll see if those calls for a public inquiry result in one in the coming weeks.